society and culture, I think the beauty about where we're evolving as a society and culture right now is that we're getting away from the whole idea of this is your career and this is the career that you're going to have for life, right? So oftentimes I think as a young adult, you're pressured to find out what you want to be at such a young age. And that's hard because you're just like, wait, I'm discovering that I like this, I like that, I like this. Like, am I crazy for liking all these things?
Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome to Hustle with Purpose. I'm your host, Romeo Marquez Jr. Our goal for this show is to introduce you to people and ideas that will help you turn your passion into a profession, ideas into action, and your creativity into a career so that you live a life with purpose. Today's guest is a women's health and lifestyle coach who has dared to lead hundreds of women down a path of radical self-acceptance, gaining her recognition by global founder and CEO of Thrive Global, Arianna Huffington, as one of the top 20 health and wellness role models. She has partnered with some of the most prestigious brands in the world, such as Nike, Adidas, Puma, Under Armour, SoulCycle, and countless others. She is the founder behind GoFitJo, which has amassed a following of over 80,000 people, a thriving blog of 20,000 readers a month, all following the road to radical self-acceptance and redefining wellness on their terms. Additionally, she has been interviewed and featured in countless publications such as Refinery 29, Glamour Magazine, Teen Vogue, Thrive Global, and many, many more. She is raw, vulnerable, wise, and a bad mother hustler who has been called the queen of messy conversations and humbly notes herself as a woman in progress. I am honored to welcome the founder and editor of GoFitJo and a woman who, as vulnerability expert, Brené Brown might say, has let go of who she thinks she's supposed to be and embraced who she is. Let's welcome Joanne Encarnacion. Jo.
What's up, dude?
Thank you so much for being here.
Oh,
I appreciate
you. I'm excited
for what we're about to talk about.
We're gonna talk about all the things.
Everything.
All the things.
So let's just start from the beginning. So how did you get to where you are today?
So GoFitJo actually started off all from a hashtag. It started off as my own like personal wellness journey because I was burned out from working in the startup culture. And I was noticing that I was depressed, overworked, overstressed, and living a life that wasn't filled with a lot of like just joy. And on paper, I had it all. I have my girls, my two daughters, my husband, an awesome career at a startup, living in the Bay Area, but still deep inside of me, there was something that was missing. And the piece of that part that was missing was actually taking care of myself and loving myself for who I was. And it didn't happen until, I guess the biggest aha moment for that journey was when my daughter and I were getting ready one day and she looked at me and she was like, "Mom, you're so beautiful." And I said, "No, I'm not, I'm ugly and fat." Like just the same way women would talk to their friends in like the dressing room, it just came out casually. And the look on her face is one that I'll never forget. And it was one that like I knew instinctively and intuitively that that was a thing that was keeping me from living my happiest life, was me not being happy with who I was becoming. And so 2 weeks later, I decided to embark on a journey just taking care of myself. And as you know, in the Filipino culture, taking care of yourself is like known as being selfish, right? Like if you don't put your community, your family first, like you're selfish. And that was definitely this cultural messaging that I had to rip apart so that I could become a better version of who I am. And that's kind of how GoFitJo started, honestly. It was a documentation of my health and wellness journey from the day one of my struggles, my accomplishments, my hate for going to the gym, but knowing that at the end of it, like there was gonna be something beautiful and inspiring out of it.
Beautiful. What was your childhood like?
Oh, my childhood. My childhood is rough.
I want to start from the beginning.
No, we're starting from the get-get. Okay. My childhood, I think, was really rough. I was born first generation Filipino, so my parents came from the Philippines all the way to New York, actually.
Oh.
Yeah. My mom wanted to do the whole Ellis Island, like I'm an immigrant, I'm going to pass to the Ellis Island kind of thing when she was pregnant. And I was born in Queens, Astoria. My parents lived out there till I was like maybe four or five. and was like, forget the snow, I'm out of here, let's move to California. Okay. And you know, growing up, like, there was definitely a lot of cultural belief systems that I constantly challenged and constantly questioned, because deep inside I knew that they weren't in alignment with who I was. Mm-hmm. And it just didn't feel right to me instinctively. There were things of just like who you should be growing up, or who you should be when you get older, go be a doctor, go marry rich, like all those kind of belief systems. And I was like, man, that's not who I want to be. I want to pursue what I'm passionate about, mm-hmm. whatever that passion might be in that moment. And there was a lot of fighting, for sure, you mm-hmm. know? There was, I mean, I think in their eyes, I was the rebellious one. And for me, I was like, I'm just trying to find my voice. I'm just trying to create who I am. Mm-hmm. So, you know, in my household, there was unfortunately a lot of yelling and fighting. My brothers and sisters were 10 and 8 years older than me. And so wow. I basically grew up with like two sets of parents and two sets of disciplinarians, which meant there was just a lot of what I guess the American culture would look as more of domestic violence right. and abuse. And for me, it was like, well, this is the only way they knew how to discipline, which wasn't okay, but it was also the only thing they knew. So there was a lot of that growing up. And although there was a lot of like joy, I think, like growing up, there was just definitely a lot of struggle mm-hmm. for my upbringing mm-hmm. within my family, for sure.
And so, you grew up in the Bay, and then you went straight to, after high school, you went to college.
Yeah, so after high school, one of the things that I discovered in high school was my love for doing hair. And I think for me, like, hair has always been a form of self-expression. Mm-hmm. And it was the one thing that as a woman, or as a young girl, you're like, how can I reshape my identity over and over again without it being completely permanent, right? As a teenager, you're like, oh, well, hair and makeup, cool. And so I remember the first time I got like this amazing haircut, I was like, oh my God, this is who I am. Mm-hmm. You know, this is who I am. This is, I cut my hair short because I was kind of rebelling over the whole, you're supposed to have long hair as a Filipina and it's supposed to be beautiful, right? Like that's the only time like men will want you. And I was like, screw that, like I'm cutting it short. And I cut it short and I remember embracing that identity and I remember thinking, I want to also give this to other people. So my first career was actually doing hair. Oh. And I went straight out of high school into beauty school. And that career was a bit of a struggle too, because my mom didn't want to support that.
Right.
You know, she was only going to support and pay for college education that was going to be on her terms.
Right.
And for me, I was like, no, like I need to be happy with whatever I'm doing in my life, because I'm only going to be answering to me.
Right.
And so I went into beauty school, but I remember the first day, this is what was kind of jacked up.
Yeah.
The first day of beauty school, I thought everything was like, you know, a registration was all situated, payments were all paid. This is how bad my mom did not want me to go. I got to school on the first day and they were like, you haven't paid for your tuition. And I was shocked, because like deep inside I was like, there's nothing else I want to do right now, right, except for this. And it was such an embarrassing moment, because for about 2 hours I was sitting outside until my mom finally like came to her senses and like supported me in that.
Wow. Yeah. And what was that dialogue like to pursue, you know, what you wanted to do during that time?
Oh, that dialogue was rough. Mm-hmm. You know, it was like, you're never gonna make money doing hair. You're never really gonna be super successful doing that. You should get a good job with health insurance and like get married, and like that was it, you know? And mm-hmm. I was like, that's just not the life I want. Mm-hmm. It's not something that I want to do. And I wanted to do hair because there was a creative expression out of it. Mm-hmm. And there was an ability to make people feel good about mm-hmm. themselves. And I think that was just something that they couldn't quite understand. So there wasn't a discussion. It was more of like, this is what they believed in, this is what I believed in, and we just like butt heads about it, mm-hmm. left and right.
And when did they fully accept what you're doing now?
Wow, I think they fully accepted it the moment they started to see that I was doing something more than just cutting hair. So during my career as a hairstylist, I also went into becoming a platform artist and an educator for a hair company called Rusk. And during that period, I was traveling and teaching haircutting techniques and color techniques on stage for other hairstylists. And I think that was the moment my parents were like, oh, this is something serious.
Yeah, yeah. It's not just cutting hair. And...
she's just not the $8 like supercuts like hairstylist, you know?
Right.
And I honestly don't know if they've really actually fully accepted it, mm-hmm. that path, mm-hmm. to be truthfully honest. I remember when I purchased my first car, I was like, I did this on my own, you know, like, mm-hmm. this is what I did. And I thought that that could have been that key to the acceptance of just like, see, right. you told me I couldn't like make money out of this career. And right. here I am supporting my family with it. Amazing. And like buying my car. And my mom was proud, but it was definitely that like, I'm proud of you, Anak, but what else are you going to do? And I'm like, oh my God, I can't win. I right. can't win.
So we were talking earlier about the different career paths mm-hmm. that you went down, and it's helped you in many ways to get to where you are today,
yeah.
right? And so just talk about like, we have to go through some of those careers to actually start living out our creativity or living out our passion. And it's still a discovery process at the right. same time, right?
Right, right.
So what are some thoughts around just going to these different jobs to get those experiences and as well as finding yourself?
Yeah, I think, you know, society and culture, I think the beauty about where we're evolving as a society and culture right now is that we're getting away from the whole idea of this is your career and this is the career that you're going to have for life, right? So oftentimes I think as a young adult, you're pressured to find out what you want to be at such a young age. And that's hard because you're just like, wait, I'm discovering that I like this, I like that, I like this. Like, am I crazy for liking all these things? I remember high school, I was like, I want to be a lawyer. I want to be a therapist. I also want to do photography. I wanted to do all these things. And I remember thinking there's not enough time in the world to do all these things and get that education. But I want to find a way to pursue those things that I'm interested in. And I think like one thing I always like try to, you know, instill in people or even in myself is like pursue what makes you happy. Pursue the passion that makes you happy in the moment and discover if that's something that you want to do for a lifetime.
Right.
And I think like we get so hung up on this idea that like everything has to be a permanent decision when the reality
that's
is
good.
Everything is an experiment, right? Like everything is we are big ass social experiments basically, right? And we put ourselves into like this thing called life and we're like, what's going to work with us today? Mm-hmm. What are we going to feel like and how are we going to grow in the next 5 years or 10 years or whatever? But we have to pick and pull from the things that we like and don't like to make that understanding and to learn that about ourselves.
Right. Let's say I'm a college student and I want to get started on like, you know, living my passion, but it doesn't match with my major. What would you suggest or advise in that regard to that college student?
I mean, I think too, like for that college student, one thing to think about is, you know, sometimes your passion doesn't have to be necessarily your career, right?
That's good, yes.
And so pursue your passion. Pursue your passion because sometimes that passion takes you away from maybe like that hardship of what your actual day job is or whatever. Mm-hmm. Until you really understand, like, is this passion something that you're constantly daydreaming about? Are you dreaming about how to make that passion bigger than your actual like career or major or choice? And the moment that shift starts to happen when it almost like tips the scale, mm-hmm. that's when you start asking yourself those hard questions of like, wait, do I really want to pursue this over this thing that I signed up for? Right. And that's when you ask yourself those tough questions. Mm-hmm. But for now, I think grow the passion,
yeah.
nurture it, see mm-hmm. where that takes you, because maybe that passion is just kind of like your escape from like what you're mm-hmm. actually doing. And that's okay too, because that keeps you striving in what you're doing as well.
Right, and experiment.
Experiment.
Right?
Yeah.
If it excites you, brings you joy, like why not?
Why not?
So let's say I'm a college student that just graduated. I'm, you know, starting to settle into my career as an entry level kind of person, mm-hmm. but I know there's something more that I can do with my life that brings me greater joy.
Yeah.
You know, thoughts around that.
I think like one thing that you could explore, and this is what when I was working at VSCO as a director and I had a bunch of direct reports, one of the things that I'd always encourage my employees to tell me about is what they're passionate about and what they're maybe interested in. Mm-hmm. One thing to do if like you're in an entry level position is talk to your managers and see, hey, I might want to work on this particular project or I'm interested in doing this. And see if there's a side project that you might be able to actually work on outside of what your actual job tasks are. And this gives you an opportunity to just test the groundwaters or test the waters out to see if it's something that you want to pursue or do. Mm. And that at least you can help shape a conversation with your manager. You can help shape the conversation with your team and hopefully redirect yourself into a job role that you're actually really happy with. Mm-hmm. Or maybe it's like a way of like saying, you know what, that wasn't actually what I wanted to do. Right. I'm gonna still keep fostering this thing that I'm doing now. Right. And then I'll figure out what else that I wanna do. But I think the biggest thing I learned in like startup culture is that there's always opportunities and projects to try something different.
That's right.
Even if it's for a day and try the shoe on, see if it fits.
Right. Now you being a director, and then transitioning to actually, you know, creating that business of your own. Mm-hmm. What was that transition like? Because I know a lot of, you know, people who have settled into their career, they go, I want to do it, but I got to, you know, take care of the family. I got to pay for this, X, Y, and Z. Like, how did you know when you were going to take
when GoFitJo was going full time. So I launched my blog in 2013. And it was just a side project. It was something for
while me. While you were working?
While I was working my full-time job. It was something I just needed as a creative outlet. I wanted to find a way to marry my love for photography, creative writing, and figured, hey, you know what? I'm just going to start this blog, and it's going to be a way for me to build an audience and to write my thoughts and to write like my own journey out. And it was a slow process. It wasn't anything that I thought would come out of. I didn't think anything would come out of it, to be truthfully honest. And honestly, I didn't even want to like make anything out of it. I always wanted GoFitJo to be just this side hustle for me. Over time, I think because the things that I was sharing on my blog and platform were all about depression, anxiety, other aspects of health and wellness that as a society we weren't really talking about or being real and raw about, it just picked up. And in 2016, I remember thinking to myself, I'm getting burned out with the startup culture. I think it's time to do something more. I keep dreaming about my passion. Mm-hmm. I'm daydreaming while I'm at work about it. And when is the right time for me? And so fall of 2016, this is a story that, you know, might happen for some people here, but I actually got pushed out of my job. I got laid off. Mm. And it was literally divine timing of the universe. Yes. Because I don't think I would have left that job had I not been pushed off that ledge. I was already teetering, thinking, should I stay, should I go? And it was the push that I needed to actually like go off and fly.
Right. So you spoke about, you know, struggles that you've been through, and you brought up anxiety and depression. I know especially a lot of young people are experiencing, you know, that particular topic. What are your thoughts on that and helping them to just overcome those struggles or anxieties or whatnot?
I think the biggest thing is to know that everybody struggles with a little bit of depression and anxiety. And I think that, and I'm hoping that by hearing that, by like me just saying that, people know that they're not alone in that struggle. And the only way to destigmatize like the shame and feeling that struggle on your own is to talk about it. Mm-hmm. And so often I think, especially in like my own upbringing, Filipino-American communities, like, we never talked about anxiety, depression, mental health, emotional wellness.
We just brush it under the rug.
Right? Brush it under the rug. We don't have that conversation. Mental health is so stigmatized, as well as treatment is so stigmatized, that it's hard to ask for help. And also, like, Filipino culture is like one of the things I remember, one of the cultural messaging that I remember my mom telling me was like, never ask for help. Interesting. Don't ask for help, you know? Like, and it wasn't because you were viewed as weak. It was just don't ask for help because you're gonna owe them something. Mm-hmm. And so that was this kind of like cultural messaging that like I knew I had to like break even within myself, because I was like, if I don't ask for help, I'm never gonna get help.
That's good. Yeah,
and I think like, you know, for those who are struggling with depression, anxiety, know that like asking for help and seeking help is not something to be ashamed of. Mm-hmm. It's a hard thing to kind of go through that alone and know that you're not alone, and got to talk about it. We got to break that stigma.
Yeah. And so in life in general, what resources have helped you along the way to just elevate your personal and professional life?
I think some of the resources for me have been, obviously, therapy has been awesome. We talk about this all the time. We're both personal development junkies.
Yep.
So I'm constantly reading books on personal development, and I remember being a kid and I was like, I'm never reading self-help books. And now in my 30s, I'm like, give me all the self-help books. Like, I want all of them. But yeah, like books, friends are like amazing resources, and other coaches around me. Like building a community of people that you can just lean on and rely on is something that's been the biggest resource in my life.
Yeah. So let's say I am somebody that's, you know, wanting to reach out, but, you know, it's like, I don't want to ask for help, or I don't want to reach out to that specific community because I'm afraid of that, you know, rejection, or afraid that I'll be, you know, shamed upon. How do you, like, break through that, like, fear in itself? Of just taking that first leap.
Yeah, taking that first leap is hard. I mean, if finding a community is the is challenging for you, then maybe finding a friend or an outlet. Sometimes also reaching out to a stranger who might not know your own struggle. Right. Like the amount of people who DM me when I start sharing the most intimate pieces of my own journey, my intimate pieces of my struggle, that reach out to me about their own relationships and their own struggles in their marriages, or their struggles with their body image, or their struggles with their weight, or whatever, is so beautiful. And I think what I've learned is that people want to receive and give help. Mm-hmm. And I think, right, like if you can just remember that, like, someone wants to help you, mm-hmm, it's gonna be okay. And receiving help is gonna be something that is your biggest power.
Right.
I also think too, like journaling.
Yes.
Journaling is something that, if you don't want to ask for help, just get your thoughts on paper. Even if it's 5 minutes a day to just start scribbling what you're thinking of, mm-hmm, in your mind. It gives you an opportunity to slow down your thoughts, put it on paper, and this way you can process it when you're reading it later.
Right. And don't judge the thought as you write.
Don't,
like, don't erase. Just like
let it go.
Out.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
And so as you go on this path of life, certain decisions had to be made. What was one of your hardest decisions that you had to make?
My hardest decision. There's plenty of hard decisions. I think maybe one of the hardest decisions I actually had to make is not going back to a 9-to-5 job. I, you know, when I got laid off, I still went and checked out Facebook, and still went and checked out Instagram to see if, like, those are potential opportunities for me to go back into a stable life, mm-hmm, a stable career, mm-hmm, and one that I knew was going to give me a really, really great foundation. The hardest decision was not to go, because it's put me on a path of, like, mm-hmm, entrepreneurship and struggle and a constant hustle, which is beautiful on its own, but it's definitely got its challenges. It's got, yeah, a growth challenge.
Right.
And it was a hard decision, mainly because I knew that, like, if I was gonna go down this path, I'm a hustle, mm-hmm, and there's no turning back.
That's right.
You know?
What are a couple of myths you wanna debunk around entrepreneurship? Because it sounds glamorous, it sounds cool, but people forget about the hustle.
Oh my God, you're working 24/7.
Right.
Or 36 to seven. It's like there's enough 36 hours in a day.
Right.
Like, you're working,
right,
all the time.
So people think, like, oh, I want to get into entrepreneurship so I could, you know, have more freedom. So I could, you know, have, you know, more time for myself. Yes, that can happen. Yes.
Right.
It's work. It's
work.
Hustling.
Work. I think, yeah, that's definitely one of them. It's this whole, like, luxury that we have, this free time and this leisurely time, like, do whatever we want. But reality, it's like I jump from one thing to the next and the one thing to another, and it's a hustle, and it can be very exhausting. And that's why I think, you know, I don't always encourage the jump to people.
Right.
I always, like, let them know, like, hey, it's hard. It's a really, really beautiful one, and it's gonna teach you a lot. But just know that, like, if you end up failing or needing to take a step back, don't judge yourself for it either. Mm-hmm. You've experienced it, and that's fine. I think also, a lot of people think that, like, once you start your own thing, that it's like you're making money, like, immediately.
Right.
And, like, sometimes I'm like, no, not really. In, right, the first couple of years, you're putting a lot of your own effort into that, especially if you don't have capital, or especially if, like, you're maybe like myself, which is a solopreneur instead, right, of somebody who's, you know, creating an actual corporation. Mm-hmm. So sometimes those are really hard. And I think too, like, it looks so glamorous on the outside, but what people don't realize is the amount of rejection that you go through also, of having to maybe ask for things, or, you know, for, I know a lot of people, a lot of my friends who are starting startups and trying to get funding, the amount of rejection that they go through as an entrepreneur to just ask for money for their businesses to grow is like difficult. Right. And even though I'm not looking and seeking funding for anything that I'm doing, the number of rejection that I might get from just like emails of trying to like connect with the right people, or, you know, whatever, or like trying to build something more, mm-hmm. is like, oh my God.
Right.
But it also teaches you something, right? Like, it allows you to say, what is it that I need to actually be doing? And also, I said this before in a podcast, but rejection is just redirection anyways, right?
Oh, that's good. Say that again.
Rejection is redirection.
I love that.
So it's like, you know, you might not be going in that right path, but like, it's just redirecting you to something that's greater or bigger for you.
Right.
Or your true calling.
Right. Well, one of the principles I hear, or that I received around like getting rejected, no means next. So when I hear the word no, it really means next.
Right.
And then there's also this other thing that I teach people. It's SW to the fourth power. SW, 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 which stands for some will, mm-hmm. some won't, so what? Someone's waiting.
Right? I like that.
And it's shifting your perspective of the rejection.
Right.
And so for those, again, young people that might not have experienced a lot of rejection, what do you want to share around that?
I mean, I think one of the things that it's just a little nugget that I remember reading somewhere, and it was that failure is just a stepping stone to success.
Yes.
And I remember when I read that, I was like, oh, okay, like that, like I get it now. Like I get it, like failure is not gonna be something that I'm gonna allow myself to like hang over, mm-hmm. or get like that failure hangover that you get, you mm-hmm. know? Mm-hmm. It's just one of those things where I'm like, all right, that's a mini stepping stone to whatever is greater. Similar to the rejection part, right? And so I think like for people who aren't really ready for rejection or haven't experienced that, mm-hmm. just remember that like the moment that you do, everyone's gotten rejected on something in their life.
Right.
I mean, you ask like somebody for a piece of paper and they might say no, like that's a form of rejection, right?
Right?
So
right,
like
right.
just think of it that way, that this is just arming you for what you're actually meant to do in life.
Right. And there's another thing that I've been taught based on what you just said is failure isn't the opposite of success. Mm-hmm. It's a part of success,
yep.
right?
Yep.
And so one thought as you were talking earlier around like DMs, what is like a DM you commonly get around like, you know, coaching in your field?
Yeah, so as of lately, when I first started doing my health and life coaching, I was really focused on health and nutrition coaching.
Right.
In the first year of my coaching practice, a lot of my clients were actually coming to me for relationship, career development, and personal development. Mm. And the food and exercise component were literally secondary to what our main focus was. And that was really interesting to me because I started kind of thinking about like, why are people coming to me for some of these harder things? Mm. And it's because I'm unafraid to have hard conversations and messy conversations on Instagram or on my blog, where most people kind of keep it very light and airy and fluffy. Some of the more like harder DMs that I get right now are honestly about communicating intimacy versus sex with their partners, having to navigate through lulls in their marriage or their relationship, how to have hard conversations with their partners or their spouses. Mm-hmm. For moms or for like a lot of women, I get a lot of like, how do I speak about my own desires and needs to my partner while being a mom and trying to like support everybody else and nurture everybody else around me. Mm. So they're kind of a mixture of things, but they're also these things where when I try to like break down what it is that people are trying to communicate with me, it's like, how do I communicate my needs? Mm. How do I fully express my authenticity? How do I speak my truth without being shut down, rejected, hurt, you know? And so it's been an interesting like road to navigate in the DM side, because I'm like, oh shit, that's deep. That's real deep.
And so as you work, as you live life, as you're constantly like, whether it be on shoots or writing blogs and, you know, taking care of family or whatnot, the whole work-life balance, like how do you
I think balance is bullshit.
Thank you for saying that.
Yep.
Just being upfront about it.
I think balance is bullshit. Like there is a, that entire idea that everything is supposed to be even keen all the way around is just, it's just not possible. And if you're constantly working to try to get everything even, you're going to work yourself to death. So the way that I like to look at balance is I like to think of like life as harmony. Everything ebbs and flows, right?
Ooh, that
and
was
just
good.
Just like music, you've got your highs and lows. Sometimes like family life might be right here. Sometimes career life might be right here, but then maybe on the second day it's here. So everything is just gonna have its own harmony in life.
That's good.
Yeah, so I just think like if you feel like you're in flow, if things feel easy, if it feels like to you the resistance isn't constantly pushing you back, then you're in your harmonious state.
Mm-hmm.
You're good. You're in your flow.
Right.
Right? So that to me is kind of like how I look at things. And I also look at things in like, you know, as far as like exercise and balance and eating well, I now today think about what's right for me in that moment.
Mm.
What do I actually need today? Am I gonna need 30 minutes of exercise today, or do I really need to just 30 minutes of rest? And I think that's important to take note of too, because, you know, for a lot of people who are trying to get on like their fitness on, they forget that working out is stress on the body. And if you're already stressed out because life is burning you out, you don't want to overly work yourself and burn yourself out even more. So I just ask myself, I check in, I'm like, yo, Joe, what do you want to do today?
Right. Let's talk about self-care. What do you do for self-care?
So I move every day. 30 minutes of exercise is kind of, that's kind of like my bare minimum right now.
Right. I've seen you at the gym, getting your hustle on there.
Yeah, if I can dedicate an hour, then awesome, you know. But if it's only 30 minutes, then that might be my bare minimum at that moment. I do a lot of journaling, so I definitely write down my thoughts. I meditate, but these days I've also been really focused on breath work and just taking time for myself. And not answering to anybody else but myself, which is a hard practice to do, especially as a mom, and especially when you have like a online audience, like you've got people always wanting to talk to you.
Mm-hmm.
But I think being able to just take that time for yourself is like super, super important.
Right. What do you think, let's say somebody is like going through like that struggle, what is something that you would suggest to them as a initial first step?
The struggle of like,
The balancing thing. Yeah.
Ugh, man, give yourself a break. You know, give yourself some grace.
And schedule it too.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like meaning like, you know what, you can't contact me, any like emails, nothing that,
yeah,
sorry,
I need
family.
A time out.
Just
I mean,
for
even
a quick
if
moment,
it's
yeah.
even if it's an hour. Even if it's just an hour a week to just kinda like give yourself that moment. The other thing that I recently read, which I wanna do actually, maybe you've done this before, but a 24-hour day of silence. Have you ever tried that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, yeah, I want to do that.
It's powerful.
And I think that's like another thing that I want to encourage people to also do is like, maybe it's not a day, but maybe it's like 6 hours of silence.
Mm-hmm.
And just to like cut everything off for that moment, go somewhere in the woods, like go somewhere in nature and just be.
Right.
And just be a part of whatever's going on in yourself, in your own inner world. And I think that can help to recalibrate a person's stress levels too.
Right. What keeps you going?
What keeps me going is my own determination and desire to constantly evolve. And sometimes that's tiring, but it's like when I think about it, when I look inside myself, I'm like, I love gathering information. I love being able to like know how people tick. I love being able to turn that back out and inspire people to like look at their own lives and assess their own lives and question some of their own things and really kind of reshape a world that they can imagine within their own hearts.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what keeps me going. I mean, my family also keeps me going for sure, but it's seeing the possible for them too.
What's the ultimate goal?
The ultimate goal, I think, if I could be like a little Mother Teresa right now.
Handle it.
I think my ultimate goal would be that everybody can reach a place of radical self-acceptance.
Mm.
That they can look at the traumas and the pain of their past and turn pain into power.
Ooh, girl. Amen. Like, I'm raising my hand here.
That they can, you know, look inside themselves and say, this is what I want for me. And I'm going to trust that the universe, God, whatever higher power they believe in has the right things there for me as long as I'm being true to myself. Mm. And as long as I can accept myself for like the messiness and the beautiful moments and all those things. So to me, I think that would make, that would be like the ultimate goal, is to just give them, give people that sense of self-acceptance.
That's beautiful.
Yeah.
Last words of advice to those that wanna fully accept themselves, to turn their pain into power and to live a life with passion.
I think my last words of advice is, you know, you're the only one who's gonna answer for yourself. And you're the only one who is going to live with yourself for the rest of your life. You'll have people coming and going in your life. Parents will be there, they'll tell you what they want you to be. Your spouse will be there, your partners in your life will want you to be a certain thing. God, even your children will also want you to be a certain thing. But at the end of the day, you're the only one who can determine what you want to shape your life to be. So take a moment to like listen within yourself and ask yourself, what is it that I want? How do I want to live my life? What do I want to do? And answer that and pursue that.
Beautiful. All right, so I have some rapid fire questions. Uh-oh. Here we go. Yep, get that sip of water. Girl, you deep. I love your soul. You're so,
thank you.
Oh, there's a lot of juiciness. I hope you guys, wherever I'm looking, yo, that girl, she deep. All right, so here we go. First thing that comes to mind, favorite day of the week?
Sunday.
Nickname your parents call you or used to call you?
Joanne. Wasn't even really a nickname.
Right, but the way it's a like, Joanne.
Joanne.
One of your favorite quotes?
It's actually my own. You are allowed to be beautiful and messy all at once.
Can I get another amen? What profession other than your own would you like to attempt?
I think I'd like to be a talk show host.
Yes, you could totally do that. Favorite breakfast food?
Bacon.
Name a book that you read that has positively shaped you.
Brené Brown's Rising Strong.
Who haven't you worked with yet that you would like to work with?
Jada Pinkett.
First word that comes to mind in Tagalog?
Aso. I don't know why, but it was that one. Okay. That was the first one.
Perfect. The most useful product or service under $100 that you've bought this year?
Gua Sha facial tools.
Who or what inspires you?
People inspire me.
Favorite childhood TV show?
Family Matters. Am I dating myself? I'm dating myself.
I love that show. If you could have dinner with three people, who would, dead or alive, who would they be?
Oprah. Imelda Marcos. I just want to ask her about a shoe collection, for sure. That woman, man. And then Barack Obama.
Perfect. Best gift you've ever received?
Best gift. A second chance in life.
Advice to your younger self.
Everything is gonna work out.
What do you think a person needs to be happy?
Passion and purpose.
And your message to the world.
Love yourself like no one else is watching.
That's good.
Yeah.
So where can people connect with you, find you, and all that jazz?
Well, I am GoFitJo on Instagram. That's GoFitJo. You can also find me on my blog at www.gofitjo.com.
Perfect. That's it, girl. Thank Sweet. You for just being you. You and just sharing your soul and your heart. And I love seeing your evolution and the growth that you're constantly creating.
Thank you.
Appreciate you.
Oh, thank
yes.
you so much. Yes.
Thank you. Ooh. Ooh. Amen. Can I get another amen? Amen.